Bien, bonjour à toutes et à tous. Désolé, je venais du fond de la salle. J'ai un peu couru. J'espère que tout va bien. Je suis ravi d'être avec vous cet après-midi et surtout à ce grand rendez-vous de l'assurance. C'est mon quatrième pour ma part et je suis toujours ravi d'être là pour parler de sujets qui sont extrêmement essentiels et notamment cet après-midi par rapport à tout ce qui a été dit ce matin. Nous allons avoir quatre panels de discussion qui dureront environ 30 minutes, voire 40 minutes pour certains, puisque nous aurons entre 3 personnes et 4 personnes, experts et expertes qui vont nous permettre de nous éclairer sur un certain nombre de choses, sur plusieurs sujets. Le premier, eh bien, le défi, les défis, les challenges des assureurs, des réassureurs face au changement climatique. Nous parlerons ensuite nécessairement de ces événements qui sont extrêmement dévastateurs, qui nous ont touchés dans notre chair, nous au Maroc, notamment le 8 septembre dernier. Je parle du séisme de la région de l'Haouz, mais on verra de manière un peu plus générale quels sont, de quelle manière les assureurs sont armés face à ces événements qui sont très peu prévisibles, qui sont extrêmement dévastateurs, et de quelle manière donc non seulement les prévenir, mais aussi gérer toutes les conséquences qu'il y a post-séisme. Ensuite, un focus sur l'assurance maritime et l'assurance maritime face aux enjeux environnementaux, sociaux et gouvernementaux. Et ça sera l'occasion de parler de différents sujets en la matière. Vous verrez, ça sera assez varié. Et enfin, on parle de grands risques. Les grandes organisations, de la même manière que les États, sont confrontés aujourd'hui à des risques qui sont de plus en plus grands, avec des conséquences qui sont de plus en plus grandes. Et donc, est-ce que ces grandes organisations sont armées, ont les personnes qu'il faut, ont identifié les meilleurs modes de management pour pouvoir appréhender ces risques et ensuite les gérer? Voilà, ça, c'est le programme de cet après-midi. Nous devons finir vers 18h. Nous avons un cocktail vers 19h. On va essayer d'aller droit au but dans chacun de ces panels. Mais pour commencer, on a le plaisir d'avoir un intervenant qui nous vient des Pays-Bas. Il représente l'Association néerlandaise des assureurs. Alors les Pays-Bas, c'est vrai que, on le sait, un pays qui gère le risque de catastrophes naturelles et notamment de submersion d'une manière absolument incroyable, puisque les Pays-Bas sont situés en dessous du niveau de la mer. Je vais vous demander d'accueillir, please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome Mr. Richard Verding, from the Association of the Insurers of Netherlands. Et il va nous parler justement des défis auxquels sont confrontés les assureurs face au changement climatique, notamment en Pays-Bas. Mr. Verding, please, you got 20 minutes.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon to you all. My name is Richard Verding. I'm the General Director of the Dutch Association of Insurers. Madame, Messieurs, bon après-midi et salutations chaleureuses de BEPA. I would like to start by thanking the Moroccan Insurance Federation for inviting me to speak here today, especially because I'm going to speak to you about a very important topic. Insuring responsibly, taking responsibility in addressing climate change. And despite the many challenges our industry and society currently need to deal with, I strongly believe that climate change is one of the greatest challenges we all have in front of us. Today, I would like to share with you some insights, and I hope the next slide will come. Yes, today I would like to share with you some insights on the following topics. First, why do we have a responsibility to come up with solutions? Second, why are Dutch insurers committed to make or keep climate risk insurable? Third, what challenges have we encountered? And fourth, what lessons have we learned? A key term I would like to use in my presentation today is responsibility, a term that is often used in discussions on climate change, but a term that can also make the discussion more difficult and that can stand in the way of finding solutions. And in my experience, taking responsibility and being held responsible are often mixed up. And I would like to illustrate this with an example. A few months ago, I was in London to attend the annual conference organized by our colleagues at the Association of British Insurers, the ABI. And when I arrived at the venue, I was greeted by not only the police, but also by a number of protesters from Extinction Rebellion. Extinction Rebellion is a very activistic NGO that organizes disrupting protests in different parts of the world, and to get attention for what they called the climate emergency. And one of the protesters came to me and said, "Well, I have a flyer for you, and you are responsible. You need to take action now." And the flyer, ladies and gentlemen, I brought with me is this flyer. And well, I think every country has to deal with this NGO in the near future. There is no more time to waste. Later is too late. And on the backside, insurers have the unique opportunity to change the course of history once and for all. Stop insuring fossil fuel projects. And because I personally do not believe that the insurance sector is responsible for climate change, that responsibility does not rest on a single company or even a single industry. It is most likely a combination of many different factors that each contributed to the changes that we see in our climate today. However, that does not mean that we as insurers have no responsibility in finding solutions to address the problems of climate change. On the contrary, we have the knowledge, we have the experience, we have the tools that we can use to find solutions and to help our customers through damage prevention, climate adaptation, and also to keep climate risk insurable. And that is our societal role, insuring responsibly. And therefore, the question for me could not be who is responsible for climate change, but who can take responsibility for addressing the negative consequences of climate change and ultimately find solutions. Having said this, let me go back to the climate change and what it looks like in the Netherlands. In an environment like Casablanca, I can imagine that climate change is usually associated with extremely high temperatures, heat waves, and prolonged periods of drought. But in the context of the Netherlands, where I have my association, our main concern is water. And where most tourist brochures picture my country as a nice and sunny place with quiet rivers, blooming flowers, tulips, you know them, beautiful windmills, watch the windmills, wooden shoes even, but the reality often looks a little bit different and a little bit more like this. As you can see, we have windmills, but we have also quite a lot of water. And there is even so much water that a large part of my country would disappear below sea level if we do not actively keep the water out. And on the map behind me, you can see all the dark blue areas which are located below the sea level and therefore have a serious risk of flooding. And what makes this even more challenging is that 70% of the population of the Netherlands lives in these blue, dark and light blue areas. And because of this challenging environment, my country had to take measures to prevent large-scale flooding. An extensive network of waterworks, so-called the Dutch Delta Program, was set up throughout the second half of the 20th century to protect the land from flooding from both the various big rivers and the sea. However, the rising sea levels and more extreme weather as a result of climate change will require new ways of thinking about climate adaptation and mitigation in order to keep flood risk manageable. So higher or better dikes are not the only way forward. You might be wondering, How do you ensure in the Netherlands the risk of flooding in a country that is largely below the sea level? The short answer is, we don't. The slightly longer answer is that ever since there was a major flood in the southwestern delta part of the Netherlands, you see behind me, it became largely an uninsurable risk. And for a long time, even by law, it was forbidden to insure these risks. In more recent decades, the government has made great efforts to improve flood prevention infrastructure. And we as an industry have tried to step by step increase the flood cover we can offer to our clients. And at the moment, we manage to cover flood damage from the failure of the so-called secondary flood defenses, generally speaking, the smaller rivers. However, until now, flooding of the large rivers and the sea remain uninsurable in our country. Fortunately, because of the good water management in the Netherlands, major floodings rarely take place. But if they do, people can only rely on a government-led system to compensate for their flood damage. And this is the Damage Compensation Act, a system which at the moment unfortunately is unclear, it is open-ended, and it is slow. The Dutch insurance industry can take a further role to step in. The sector is committed and is also prepared to also make these big river and coastal floods insurable. And there are three reasons for this position. First of all, because our customers expect it from us. And secondly, because we believe we are experts in handling claims. We have years of experience in how to deal with claims in an efficient and customer-friendly way. And under the current system of the government, the government first needs to declare the flooding as a major disaster before they can trigger an emergency compensation mechanism. The downside of this system is that the process can take quite long and the amount of compensation is not known beforehand, which creates uncertainty for those affected. Third, having private insurance gives an incentive for people to work on prevention. If businesses and individuals need to pay a premium for the risk that their property floods, they become more aware of this risk and can take action to reduce this risk. For example, taking preventive and adaptive measures like a stone floor instead of a wooden or electrical sockets halfway up the wall. In a public system, there are no such incentives for people to actively reduce their own risk. At the same time, we need to be realistic and conclude that we as an industry cannot cover the risk of a major flood in the Netherlands all by ourselves. We need the government and we need reinsurers to act as a backstop. Therefore, July last year, our association presented two possible solutions to our government. And that is not for the first time, I can tell you that. The first solution is a system of public-private re and insurance. Insurers take on part of the financial risk. The government intervenes only in really major flood disasters that Dutch insurers cannot bear alone. That is the idea. The second option, it is an adjustment of to the current Damage Compensation Act, where insurers can take over the claim settlement as a part of the arrangement. And this provides citizens and businesses with one single front office that deals with the handling of their damage. In this option, financial compensation is still by the government based on a revised law with clear definitions and conditions so that everyone knows exactly what damage is compensated and to what extent, even before a flood occurs. Now let's talk about what more we can do as insurers in addressing climate change. Again, windmills, but these are more modern. But in all seriousness, like with other risks, prevention is the best cure, also when it comes to climate change. Insurers can help in preventing further climate change through investing in more sustainable assets. And our members have committed to the carbon reduction targets that were set out in 2016 in Paris, the Climate Agreement. Furthermore, we created and signed as a financial sector, also the banks, also the pension funds, a national climate commitment together with the government. So our members nowadays invest in clean energy solutions such as wind farms and solar power. And the effects are showing. This month, the European Commission announced that despite higher energy production, the CO2 emissions by the European energy sector reduced by 47% in the last 20 years, mainly by switching from coal and oil to wind and solar. And these are the figures we like to hear and to which we try to contribute. But I would say equally important is that our members use their influence and their position as shareholders through engagement and voting in big companies that are not yet sustainable, and to help them to steer towards a more sustainable production methods and business models. Although there is always more that can be done in this field, we do see more and more positive examples where these changes are taking place, also as a result of our engagement. And we also need to stay alert that in our role as risk managers, we do not unnecessarily slow down the transition towards a more sustainable society. For example, in the energy transition, we see many of our customers that are placing solar panels on their roofs, so they become less dependent on fossil fuels for their energy consumption. But from a climate perspective, this is great. However, from a risk perspective, this development has some challenges. You see it behind me. In the Netherlands, we saw that there were a number of fires that originated at incorrectly installed solar panels. Now, a natural response from an insurance perspective could be to raise the premiums of home insurance for customers that have solar panels. However, I'm happy to say that our members did not do that. Instead of raising their premiums, our industry, together with the solar power installation companies, developed new safety standards for installation, which reduced the number of fires substantially and allowed premiums to stay stable. And I think this is a great example of how our industry can use its knowledge of risks to help the transition towards a more sustainable future, instead of slowing it down. We need to encourage the clients to change the solar power in the first place. So this is a good movement. Another thing we can do as an industry is to put our data to good use. Our association yearly publishes the so-called Climate Damage Monitor, and you can find it on our website. This interactive tool shows the development of insured climate-related losses through the years and for different types of climate-related risks, such as storm, flooding, hail, and lightning. The aim is to show how the insured losses develop through the years, and also to give our clients insights into the vulnerability to certain risks in the area where they live. We also use our data for prevention purposes. In the Netherlands, we as an association have a partnership with the Royal Dutch Weather Institute. And that is in order to issue the early warnings to policyholders when extreme weather is expected, and also combined with tips what you can do. A study by the United Nations and the Commission on Adaptation shows that such early warning systems can reduce damages up to 30%. 30%. That's quite a lot. Well, despite these good examples, there are more challenges and also barriers. We hear from our members that they struggle with the sustainability reporting requirements that come from European rules and regulations. These can make it difficult for insurance companies to put their sustainable ambitions into action. And these can be a real barrier. Another barrier is a clear transition path from the government towards a net zero economy. Since insurers invest the money of their policyholders, they need to have a clear picture of what the return will be on their investments. And this requires a clear and stable path and how we will transform our economy towards climate neutrality. Another map. And if I'm honest, we will see our government do things that do not help in keeping climate risks insurable. For example, we still see new houses, new neighborhoods being built in areas where extremely high risk of flooding. Those buildings can, according to our data, become uninsurable in the near future. And this will be very difficult to tell the people who live there. And just last week, the government in the Netherlands published a report and the map you see behind me, where they indicate in which areas of the country we can still safely build houses, where more adaptation measures need to be taken, and where building will not be possible anymore. And that is mostly along the big rivers. In these matters, it's up to our industry to point out risks and keep the conversation with politicians and policymakers going, so that hopefully in the future, insurers, or at least the knowledge that we have as insurers about climate-related risks, will be taken into account in areas such as city development and spatial planning. So ultimately, we can contribute to making the Netherlands climate adaptive. In conclusion, I promise this is the last and final picture of a windmill. What lessons did we learn in the Netherlands from the discussion on insurability of climate change? First of all, that there is a responsibility on all of us to prevent the climate from changing further and to adapt our surroundings to better withstand the effects that we already see from climate change, mitigation and adaptation. I believe that as an industry, we are uniquely placed as risk takers and investors to take that responsibility and address the problems caused by climate change. We can help our society to move from A to B like a lever. Through our investments, we can not only reduce carbon emissions, but also help the companies we invest in to evolve towards a more sustainable business model. And at the same time, we as an insurer need to make sure that we use our data to focus our investments and prevention efforts to those areas where they have the most positive effects. And as an industry, we cannot solve everything by ourselves. No matter if it is drought, flooding, or severe thunderstorms, we will need commitments and efforts also from other industries, other sectors, governments, and cities, citizens in order to effectively address this issue. Our role as insurers is to take our knowledge of risk, our data, our capital, and use those as leverage so we can create solutions for the problems that our clients and society are already facing and experiencing today. And if we manage to do that, we can show that we take social responsibility on climate change. And maybe, just maybe, we can even make the climate protesters of Extinction Rebellion a little bit proud. Insuring responsibly. Thank you very much for your attention. Madame, Monsieur, merci beaucoup.
Merci, Monsieur Verdier.